this week inside the Juno Reactor, it's a pleasure to welcome a percussionist, a drummer, a friend, Greg Ellis. He has performed and recorded with artists from all over the world, including the great Zakir Hussain, the great Ayata Mairaire, Kodo drummers Mickey Hart's Planet Drum. He's recorded for all the great film composers, all of which you would have heard or seen at the cinema. What sets him apart for me is his playing can be as furious as a street fighter and as delicate as a brushstroke. He is a very unique percussionist, and I hope you enjoy our conversation inside the Juno Reactor. Welcome to Inside the Juno Reactor, Greg. It's a pleasure to have you here.
Yeah, pleasure to be here. It's been a long time, so.
Is it since we actually have worked
physically
together?
It's been a long time. I know we talked a few times here and there, but I'm trying to remember the last time. Was it the DJ gig out here that you did? Could that have been all the way back to then?
when we did that live improv.
Remember that one? Sorry, up in Calabasas or something?
That was really funny, wasn't it? And that singer, and there was that great girl singer who is the sister of the promoter.
That's right.
And she was wicked.
My sister sings, or my girlfriend can sing, but she nailed it. It was really, that was
she's a really good singer. I've seen her do other stuff as well.
Yeah.
But I sort of want to front load this with sort of like maybe we go back to, I think when we met, which was pretty close to when the Matrix sort of stuff happened. I think from my memory, I just worked with Steve Stevens.
Right.
I came out to California and we met at the Standard Hotel. Was that right?
Yeah. That's right. And then we came back to my place and sat up in the studio when it was upstairs here. And I think we listened. I played a little bit. I think you had your flute or something. You played a little bit or something. I don't know what.
Did I?
But
I played a flute.
We hung a bit. But yeah, we came back here afterwards. I think I picked you up there and we came back. But
okay.
It was right after you did Pistolero.
Okay. So it was
Or even we're writing Pistolero at that time. I don't even know if you'd finished it yet. So then you called me and you had set up at Paramore. Which was like walking into the Matrix, wasn't it? That whole setup there was just incredible.
Well, I remember that, like, with which is sort of like Mabi's podcast reminding me of, like, I remember saying to Mabi, you know, do you fancy coming and working on this film called The Matrix? And he was like, he was like, no, I want to look after my chickens.
I love that quote. It just like embodies Mabi. You know?
I don't know if any of his chickens ever survived.
I think he
built three houses and they all fell down because none of them had foundations.
Oh God. But, I'm trying to imagine his life there, but yeah, but that was, so he didn't come out for Reloaded. He came out for Revolution.
No. And I was sort of panicking because I was thinking, well, percussion is quite an important part. So I immediately got on the phone to Ayeta Moreira, who was also working for B&W. And I know the first one was the Indian guy, the Masters of Percussion.
Wait, not Zakir Hussain.
Yeah, Zakir Hussain.
Oh, I didn't know you actually approached Zakir.
He was my first thought.
I'm sure he would be, but yeah.
And then someone said to me, oh, he's 10 grand just to get out of bed.
Right.
And I thought, ooh. Right. So I thought, I'll ring up Ayeta. Ayeta said, no, I'm going off on tour. And then the studio said to me, as I was progressing through this stuff, why don't you use that guy who, you know, the really famous percussionist in the LA orchestras? What was, you remember what his name was?
Was that Mike Fisher?
I think it was, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. He's the generation above me, but like that incorporated all the world music stuff and everything.
So
yeah.
Like we were already just weren't used to that, you know, because everything was new to us at that time.
Right. I remember.
And
yeah.
Zig, we had an old head there, you know, who's brilliant at it. But I remember that guy turning up with a massive Arctic lorry, pretty much, of percussion. And his roadies were coming with all these massive flight cases with shakers and things and massive taiko drums. Right. And me and Greg, the engineer, sitting back going, this doesn't work. It was so delicate, you know, it just wasn't the Mabi that we were looking for. And so when, yeah. I think I then rang you up and you came down with a bag of things and it just worked.
Yeah. I mean, it's nice to be in that kind of small group of a list of players to be considered, you know, but I think with any of those players, it's.
Well, it's only because you came to the standards.
It was more than just needing tabla or Latin percussion or something. And one of the first tracks we did was Mona Lisa Overdrive, where I got on kit. And so to incorporate that and have access with the kit and then the nagaras and then the specialty sound with
exactly,
what we had
yeah.
already done, it gelled so quickly, I remember. But that's when you got the sense of a kind of even expanding your initial ideas of percussion, I think, and really made it, I don't know, a different kind of driving force. Certainly with the kit. I mean, that track still,
I remember,
like one of my favorite kit tracks.
The intro of that is called Dante, was called Dante.
Right.
But although it's all one long Mona Lisa Overdrive, but that's when you were doing the kit drum.
Right. The on-ramp when they're getting on the freeway.
Yeah, right. Which sounds amazing. Still sounds amazing.
That was
amazing.
Fun. But just setting up kit in there, I remember we just opened, mic'd everything and used the room, and it was just, everything felt, it didn't feel like, oh, let's try this. It felt like it was kind of being directed. And once we heard something that worked, yeah, cool, let's move on. And we didn't trip on stuff really, you know, we didn't spend an hour on a shaker or anything like that. We really kind of, I remember, moved quickly through ideas.
I think
stuff.
We did, yeah. I mean, if I remember rightly, I think Mona Lisa was about a month or something in getting it to the point of green lighting it or...
Because your thing was all, what you would do is we would record these kinds of cues as songs almost, like 3, 4, 5 minute pieces. But then you would spend so much time of the arrangement of having to fit it to the frame and seeing what needs to hit. And that's where I think your composition was really in how you constructed these cues. Because nothing sounded like how we laid, certainly like something like Navras as well. I mean, how we laid that down. I remember coming back when you spent your 2 weeks with it and it was just like a sculpture, you know, you took all these elements and built them in such this beautifully balanced way that's what you do. You know?
I think it's part of my dyslexia that I've got an overview of something, although it looks like chaos or sounds like chaos. You know, I can imagine it when I think I've got all of the bits, I know that then I can go into the linear mode.
Right.
And,
I see that.
But I remember there's that really lovely bit in Mona Lisa when it really does hit the percussion. It's when the cars bang together
right.
and you really get this really great sort of percussion and orchestra all
right.
sort of syncopating together.
I remember that. I remember you saying something, can you play, I don't know what it would be, like 30 second note triplets at 208 beats a minute or something. Well, we can certainly try, you know, but the way Mabi had his stuff laid down, I don't know. I remember that that was like the first thing where we really got into like that kind of driving stuff. But the way he uses the darbuka in that track too, once it's on the freeway.
That was the really nice stuff, yeah.
Coming in and out, I think, was so effective. It wasn't this constant thing of all these big drums underneath. It, your bass line would carry it for a bit, you know? And I don't know. I just love the way it all kind of arranged. And it gave me a sense of how percussion can be used in those kinds of things as well. I do a lot of video game work now, and it's like, it's
exactly. I mean, we could go back now to the other stuff that you've done, because you've done, you know, tons and tons of films working with composers, and you've obviously worked with many composers in the film industry. And I was watching the bio doc that you sent me,
yeah,
and you had quite a lot to say about how this. You know, now that so many libraries are available, you rarely get sort of people who don't really understand percussion, programming right. percussion. And you think that's a loss of like historical rhythms, talents.
I think talent, yeah, absolutely. When you're looking at it purely as what, like someone like Emil Richards, who is legendary and not a lot of people know him. He played with Frank Zappa and Frank Sinatra and played on over 2000 films. And his perception of what rhythm would do, like what we were just talking about, I think if you had used a traditional percussionist, which would essentially be the best Indian loop library, would be Zakir Hussain. He could, anything Indian you would want, he'd be able to do. So what I've found in a lot of film music was whenever I go in and play something traditional, a darbuka or something, and I start playing a groove, they just want ba 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 ba. They want straight 16th. This is, but they want it played in a way that has this aggression that doesn't work with this light finger technique, you know? So I think that approach of being able to take these instruments that aren't being traditionally represented, like in a loop library, it limits the palette of sound that a composer can use, where you can use a darbuka, but mute it and treat it in a way that it sounds nothing like a darbuka, but it has an attack that really works. And that's a creative jam session that I would always do with composers. We would try things. I'd try a nagara, but I wouldn't play it with sticks. I'd play it with my hands and put goat nails on it and do all this stuff that made it sound, you know, had nothing to do with what the instrument was called. And I think that limits composers now, because they think any of these traditional drums, and they only have access to them played mainly in traditional ways.
And is that mainly like due to a sort of financial restrictions that they're now under the new budgets and Netflix and Amazon, and their budgets are, is it down to that?
It's down to that. And where the creativity is falling now, the new film world is in video games. I've been working a lot with Sony PlayStation, and I've done over the last 2 years, about 6 different titles. It's the same production, music production team. So whatever composer comes in, they'll say, oh, you got to get this guy in there. So I'm coming in, and it's creative. It's experimental. It's notated. It's like everything that the film business was. But these film composers are now in the video game industry, because that's where the budgets and the time freedom is. You know, it takes a year and a half to work on it, so they don't have these constraints of times and budgets. But in the film world, it's rare. Maybe 2 or 3 films a year now I do, as opposed to 10 or 15 I used to do.
Wow.
It's that drastic. And it's because specifically they don't need my 15 darbukas, because they have a library of 115 of them, you know. So
yeah, but I mean, I've got certain libraries myself, but it's like drum kit, and you can put any old drum kit together, and sort of then they've got the pre-rhythms that you can muck around with and generally put it down as a staple, sort of, yeah, that'll work for the time being type of thing. But what I think they all lack is just the natural instinct of a great drummer playing on the track that will do things that a program will never really come up with, especially myself. I mean, I've programmed a lot of drums.
Yeah.
But I wouldn't really, you know, sometimes simplicity on these things is the best thing sometimes. But then when you say like tracks like Superman, Perfect Crime, Superman.
Yeah.
No one would expect. I remember when we were in the studio in Ridge Farm.
Yeah.
And I think that was one of the first times you came over to England and did a session for me.
Yeah, and we really set up everything and did kit and everything live and really just jammed and really explored together, I think. But that was the first time.
And I remember thinking, like, if when you first started playing, it was quite polite.
Yeah.
And I remember I was thinking, why is it this sort of like sounds, you know, like he's sort of already holding back. And I remember saying to you something like, Greg, just ready fucking hit those drums.
You said something. I've tried to remember what it was. But, you know, honestly, to my ears, programmed drums sound polite. You don't hear the... So no matter how heavy or distorted you treat it, it's perfect. It's nice. You know, it's clean. It's orderly. And so I think when I would first start playing with electronic music, I would try to play like electronic. And you were like talking, no, this is like... Bonham, like let's like bash through this in a way,
because it's the attitude there, isn't it? It's part of it. There's like it felt like there was a wall had suddenly been broken, and then the wave of sort of almost pure anger came out on a ballad, which I thought was brilliant, and it was ferocious. And I think it's not just that you get like a sample snare and you've got someone going, oh, I've already hit it hard and it sounds really aggressive.
That's right.
It's all of the aggression between all of the drums.
All the drums, exactly right.
In one go, exactly. You know, that is a really powerful thing. And it's not really to diss these libraries, I suppose. It's more that I think you get a lot more out of face-to-face.
I have no judgment or critique. I don't like comparing the two any longer, because I think the electronic music, like you first said, these libraries and these instruments, in the right hands, you create art. But you've been in the room with live drummers. You've been in the room with some of the best musicians in the world, from all around the world, and all the stuff you've done. I mean, just the list on the Matrix, but every album, you've worked with Mabi, you've been inside that rhythm. So those instruments in your hands, it's like a chef that is a, you know, opens up a Chinese restaurant, but has never had Chinese food. You got to taste it. And I've been lucky enough
to be in those situations where it was just a natural progression of events.
Right. You don't necessarily think like a drummer, you think like a musician who plays the drums, because that's what every great drummer is. We're very musical in that sense. You know, it's not coming from this technical, let me show you everything I can do. Mabi was one of the most musical drummers I've ever heard, because his patterns were not necessarily melodic, but it created this kind of gravitational motion that kept moving forward with his pitch choice and stuff that was so easy to play within and stuff. And create this. So I think it's more of who, like any instrument, it's who's playing it. So
for sure. I mean, I just prefer it. At certain times in my life, I much prefer having real musicians in the room, in the studio, the back and talk, the testing of different snares, all of these things. You know, I mean, I think when we were at the farm, we were thinking, shit, we really need about 20 snares or something. And we had about 3 or something.
Yeah, I know.
So it's sort of, but with like the composers that you've worked with, Tyler Bates was a big one that you worked with for quite a long time.
Yeah. Tyler Bates, I've worked with Bear McCreary now, Stevie Blonsky. God, I mean, so many of the biggest where they're one-offs when I do them. But like I said, it's been now about 5 or 6 years since I've really been in that loop any longer. So,
And is Tyler Bates still working in that? Is he still doing that?
He is, yeah. Tyler's doing a lot of production now, too. He just produced an album with Jerry Cantrell from Alice in Chains. He had gone on tour with Manson.
Alice in Chains were recording in the Paramore, remember?
Yeah.
When at the back end of Reloaded, they took over MySpace, and I went into post-production in a much smaller room, and they kept on...
Oh, that's right. That back room when we went back in there. That's where we did the Burly Brawl, I think. We did that there.
The never-ending Burly Brawl.
But yeah, so all these guys. Oh, Alexandre Desplat is another one of the composers that I worked with, who did Argo, but he did Tree of Life. He's the Mr. Fox, fabulous Mr. Fox, that one.
Okay, but yeah.
Beautiful, beautiful composer, and was nominated for best score for Argo. And so each of these guys, I mean, they all have their way. Like someone like Tyler would be, I've worked with him since so early on, but when we were working on 300, we didn't really have picture because everything was done on the green screen. And Zack Snyder was in Canada shooting all the stuff. So we had about a year to work on that score. So he would get footage every few months. So I just go down and do a few shakers for him and then come back a couple of days later, go lay down some frame drum or something and just really had time to explore it. But he was always kind of thing, like, give me a click track and a drone and do what I feel kind of thing. Someone like Alexandre Desplat have everything notated, but they know the instrument. So they'll write the proper rhythm for a frame drum or the proper rhythm for a darbuka. They get the difference, wow. You know? So it's a real pleasure to work with those composers that really understand.
I love his scores. You know, generally I'm sort of like my ears will prick up on his stuff and go, wow, that's really cool. Because a lot of the time you're going, oh God, the washing machine's on, you know, with the orchestra. But his stuff is really good.
I think the scores of films for nominations should be judged on the album, the soundtrack, not the watching the film. I think you can see how a score works within a film.
I'm not sure if I agree with you.
Well, I'm saying it because specifically of this, the score of Argo, when you listen to the score on the soundtrack, it's some of the most exquisite music, film music I've ever heard. In the movie, it's mixed. He was furious. It's mixed so low in the film that you literally barely hear anything. And it's a real, for him, it was frustrating because he was up against Life of Pi, which had these big open 3-minute montages of visuals where the orchestra could just soar. And he was competing with all this other components. And if you're a fan of Alexandre, then I highly recommend it. And even all the Santur that you hear is actually me playing hammered dulcimer.
Oh, wow.
I kept seeing it in the score because we had 3 days at Capitol record studio just to do percussion. He has that kind of clout here, you know, and so he wanted all the world and ethnic percussion laid down before the orchestra so they would be able to play to it. And so it was really just these beautiful sessions. He has perfect pitch. He hands writes his scores, conducts his orchestras. But we had 3 days of really diving in with also an Iranian percussionist that came in for a day. And so I kept seeing all these hammer dulcimer cues in the score folder. And I saw these things that I could pretty much play. And I said, you know, I have a hammer dulcimer. If you want me to lay this down, he's like, oh, I haven't found a Santur player yet. Can you do it? I said, yeah, sure. Let's try it. So all the Santur here in the field is actually me with a Persian tuned hammer dulcimer.
Wow. Cause I remember you were playing that in Vaz. Vaz was your previous band.
Right.
That I think when I first met you, you and Azam were still Vaz.
Right.
You hadn't sort of split your affiliations at that point.
No, we still had a couple albums, I think, ahead of us at that point. So yeah, we were still right in it. And she was one. She mainly played hammer dulcimer, but that's where I picked it up and started learning it.
And that was very much like, I mean, every musician has a love of another band or another artist. And it felt like you had a real love of Dead Can Dance at that time.
Yeah, I think that came more from her. I had a real love. I was just discovering percussion. I'd only literally been playing hand percussion maybe about 3 years by the time of the first Voss record. It was really something I was exploring. I was doing a lot of commercial scoring. And so I had my ADATs and I had, like, you know, just 16 tracks that were, you know, infinite at that time to me, of just layering different tones and composing with them and stuff. So I had all these percussion beds laid out when I met Azam, and she came in and sang in her wordless language. She was really influenced by Dead Can Dance quite a bit, like really, really into them. I had never heard them until I met her. So it wasn't an influence of what I was doing with percussion, was really being influenced by the traditional stuff of really listening to a lot of North and South India, North and South African, a lot of gamelan music, a lot of Indonesian and Eastern Asian music.
So were you inspired by people like Ginger Baker?
Oh, yeah. I mean, drum set players specifically, but I wasn't trying to incorporate drum set into my percussion at that point. When I got into percussion, I didn't touch my kit for about 5 years. I was all percussion. And I was developing a legitimate technique that I knew I was going to be playing with some of the best artists. So I couldn't be, you know, a novelty tabla player, a novelty frame drummer. So I had to find something of my drum set playing and incorporate it into this percussion. And that's how I developed the kit that I play, the darbuka and udu and frame drum together. So I'm still thinking like kit, it's still my native language. So you don't hear my accent, you know, it's not like I'm trying to do something.
So were you
else.
Coming in from the sort of punk rock sort of area as well?
Yeah, and hard rock stuff too. But yeah, I mean, it really that energy of the kit, I really wanted to generate not from four limbs, but, you know, eight fingers going on these smaller drums. And I just found a way when I could play it horizontally, it really gave me that kind of power. So Voss really helped me establish that kind of feel. So I think Azam singing in her own language and her range of voice certainly being influenced by Lisa Gerrard, that kind of got that attachment to it. But for me, I really wanted to get much more of a traditional feel of the, and the first three albums are all, well, all the albums have all acoustic percussion. Well, one of our philosophical splits is that she wanted to bring in more electronic percussion. And it wasn't so much that I was like, no, I'm a purist. It's like, but I do that. So I can create loops. I can create that feel if you want. But at that time, we had a couple tracks remixed, and that's when she met Carmine Rizzo. And she then basically did Voss with electronics, and that's then started Niaz and stuff. But I just went deeper into it, and I found ways of, I don't think if I started incorporating that, became an electronic producer in any way, I don't think that would have led me to you. The same way if I learned tabla, it wouldn't have led me to Zakir Hussain. I can play with him because I don't play it tabla, you know?
I think it's quite good to be a purist. And I think with electronic music, with the way that it's going, I mean, my ears are heading off to real players at the moment, or not when I said real players, acoustic players. I don't know why. I don't know why my head's going in that direction, because I'm more likely end up with a thumping techno album or something like that. But but I think the respite or the, I hear what's going on in electronic music now, and it's sort of, I appreciate it. I appreciate the sound of it, and whether it's from hip hop or from like grime or, you know, some techno tracks, even there are even a few good psytrance tracks.
Yeah, I agree.
But there aren't many because everyone's copying each other and they're looking to jump up the tree by copying them. And they think, well, if I do a slightly better version, then people will appreciate it. But actually, no, I don't think so. I think there's so few new ideas entering the electronic space. There's great new plugins. There's great new technologies that's allowing us to analyze and pinpoint a fart in this sort of spectrum and sort of, you know, all the 3D space.
Right.
But I don't hear like, you know, really great ideas. That's the only thing that I'm really missing.
I'm with you on that. I think that really is it. It's like, I try to imagine like what that phase of your career when you met Mabi, like what your music would have sounded like if you hadn't met Mabi, if you hadn't found someone like that. Not so much that he defines it, but he became an instrument for you.
Mabi changed the trajectory of Juno Reactor by suddenly I went, wow, yeah, this, you know, because all my head and my landscapes were in space. And sort of in this sort of like fantasy space land. And then it just immediately brought it all right down to earth again. And I felt the power of it in the studio, and it totally changed a lot of my thinking almost immediately. I mean, to me, percussionists before Mabi were generally the ones that I saw, which were white guys playing bongos or congas, and it felt, and I thought I was watching a seal sort of going through a performance where you're going, what's that guy doing in the band? He does nothing. You know, I was in a band called Brilliant, and there was this guy called Chester who was playing percussion. He couldn't play percussion. It's just like a slappy, slappy seal, you know, like some shitty little groove that doesn't do anything, and he's standing there for an hour and a half doing it. And it wasn't until Mabi that I suddenly realized all of the joy, the fun, the playing of games, the rhythmic offsets and all that stuff that came into it. And so he taught me everything. But then you had a really amazing relationship with Mabi as well, because I remember when he did come over, you and him were very much glued together in Matrix Revolutions.
Yeah, that was, we first met, I was sitting on the tennis court out at the church at Dave Stewart's studio out in Encino there at the church. And he had just arrived the night before. So I came out that morning. I remember he was out there sitting. We came out and they just immediately hugged each other. I had my udu and he had something and we just started playing immediately. It was just, that's how we said hello. But I think, you know, I look back now and I kind of get chills and it's still incredibly emotional for me of, you know, I accept death and loss and cycle of life. It's not mourning a death or a person, but it really is appreciating the level of awareness and wisdom that he gave me. And what you're referring to, I think we had the time at the church as well, but then we had the time, was it for Gods and Monsters when we were there for 2 weeks at Ridge Farm and him and I stayed at the studio pretty much at the farm.
I think so, yeah. And then we also had the Brave Story film score.
Brave Story, yeah. So it was Brave something Story. In there during that time. But I remember that we had about 2 weeks together out at the farm. I'm so proud of myself for recognizing that opportunity, you know, because I usually would come back to Brighton with you and I'd stay at your place in Brighton and have that more of that experience. But I was sleeping on the floor in the studio and with Mabi, and he'd be up on his loft back there on his little mattress. But we'd take walks after working, after you'd leave or something, like, you know, 2 or 3 in the morning around those grounds and the energy and the power. And he would just start like telepathically download stuff with me. I saw him as the medicine man, as a shaman, you know, and I knew there was no other time I was going to have that time with someone like him. And in those 2 weeks, he redesigned my whole universe of what I thought rhythm was and realized the deeper responsibility of it too, because he never preached it like that. He never played the role of like, he was a clown. He was Charlie Chaplin, you know,
he was like Charlie this complete, Chaplin, yeah.
Just, you know, clown wizard of, but man, when he used that look on his face when he was in a groove, man, and it's. Yeah.
And enjoying it. Sometimes he would fall asleep a bit, wouldn't he? Like,
right.
When he was really tired, he would like, I'd have to go, Mabi, wake up.
Yeah.
And get
I
back
remember
on
that
it.
Time when we were in Japan when we filmed the DVD. The rest of the three other Pondos left. They had to go back, and we had one more festival gig in Nagisa or something, right?
By the Fuji TV thing, yeah.
Yeah. And so Mabi stayed on for 5 more days to do that gig, but the rest of the Pondos went back. And by the time I remember driving to the gig, it was like E.T. withering away. Like he didn't have his family around him. He hadn't played for 5 days, but he didn't have that energy of the tribe around him. And within 5 minutes of him getting on his drums and we started playing, it was just like, boom, he was right there again. You know, he was a powerful soul that I think really had this image of a chameleon that you never really saw who he was. And he gave me those.
What did you learn from his sort of African style that you didn't think you had previous to that?
I think maybe it was connected to what you were saying of the white boy drummer up there slapping around like a seal. Like I never wanted to be that. So at that point, it's not about what you play or how you play. The guys we're talking about, Zakir Hussain, Ayerto, you know, Giovanni Hidalgo, I mean, Mabi, they play like that. Drummers have that. It's a different connection. So when I play, if I'm doing a bar gig or a Juno gig in front of 40,000 people or a film date that's all stress, I bring the same thing to it because of what Mabi showed me. I just think in that age, during that time, when that shift of, okay, we've got to accept the technology's taking over. I stopped the fight. I stopped the battle. But I just needed to know, is what I feel real? And he showed me that it was. He gave me that wisdom that indeed what you're feeling is real. So don't lose it. Mm.
What I loved about it when we were playing live and you spoke about telepathy, and there was like within that band with like, especially started, I think that was the best gig we ever did, which was the Japan live audio experience, whatever, you know, we were always trying to catch up with that. We never really got back to that point, but it still didn't obliterate the thing of there was a telepathy where you and me, we could look at each other. And you knew that we were going to change rhythm,
right?
That we'd then go, we'd step it up gear. Or I think with Mabi was like so in the groove that sometimes you had to wake him up. But everything, it felt like we were just a reaction. And it worked quite well with the idea of the band or the name of the band. But
it's
you don't think about it, you just react to it. And that was when I think we were at our best is when we just react to anything that happens. You know, the computer breaks down or we stop the computer and everyone knows we're going to go somewhere. It's not like, it's, you know, not like in, say, like previous bands where someone had gone, what the fuck happened? You know,
right.
It's like, boom, go with that moment. And that's what I really loved about the show, that it was like that and it was capable of holding that and holding the audience like that, whether it was Squid or Taz. You know, I'd make horrible demands on Taz and say, sing, sing something, Taz. And she'd be going, what the fuck do I sing? But she was just like, she could jump in there as well and just be really brilliant. So I think we were quite lucky in that period.
It's interesting. I like the word you use as reaction. I think that's a distinction between improvisation and reaction. We were never improvising, though we had a lot of improvisational moments.
What improvisation is real true improvisation? Because, you know, I'm sure Dizzy Gillespie was playing all of those same sort of licks every day in and out in his breakfast, you know, at dinner.
Sure.
And he knew those lines. He knew everything. So it wasn't really improvisation. It was a collection of knowledge that he already had acquired that he then put
almost
together.
Almost like collage work in a way of just putting pieces together.
Well, I think that is improvisation, isn't it?
I'm thinking of it more from a place of, even if there's a chord progression that somebody's soloing over, or for a drum solo where everybody drops out and you play, where you're really creating something where it's not that. You're going to go into a space you haven't gone to and paint yourself into a corner and get yourself out. That to me is improvisation, of where it's relying on what you know, done in a way you've never done it before. But reaction, I like. What you're saying is reaction. And that's what I really, really enjoyed, is that we still had to be on our toes like a good improviser, but you just pull all the faders down sometimes and electronics would disappear. And it's me and the Pondos. And there wasn't a blink of an eye. We knew exactly what to do, you know? And then how you'd bring it back in. And I don't know, that reaction part, I really miss that. I miss reacting to the musicians around
me. I remember
me.
When we first had Steve, he turns up to this show and I said, yeah, it'd be great if you play. So he brought his guitar and I plugged him into a little Zoom rack.
Right.
It was a piece of shit. And so Steve, and this is what I love about Steve as well, is he didn't go, oh God, I need my Marshall. He just went with it.
Yeah.
And then I had him into my mixing desk and I was sort of, he'd like be doing these runs and I go, boop. I would just like pull his fader down and he'd still be playing, but he'd look at me going, what the fuck happened? And then then he knew what he was doing. So he would just play and I would like fade him in when I thought, so it's because it's an electronic gig. You can't have a rock god playing over everything, which they're used to doing, so you're sort of live mixing him, so he'd carry on playing and I'd be listening to what he was on the headphones and go, boom, let's go with that and spin it. But I think he was quite shocked with this very free form attitude, which I think the Pondos were really quite instrumental in doing that. Like when we did the Moby tour, we hadn't got a clue what we were going to do, or mainly because the European band didn't want to do it, blah, blah, blah. So when we got into rehearsal, we could just fake it. We knew we could fake a few gigs, but then the magic started to appear, you know, with Mabi or whatever, and the performances and all of this stuff. But I think around that time, the 2006, 2007, 2008, the real magic happened on stage. I was convinced. I thought, wow, this thing is so alive.
Yeah.
How come it's not like sort of really blossomed? I think it's mainly because I fucked up by doing Gods and Monsters, actually, and like the Juno fans really not digging it, you know? I should have just done the typical Juno album and everyone might have gone, yeah, this is it.
I think, you know, that was a time that the business and the market was totally shifting during that time. Like YouTube started in 2007. You know what I mean? This is, we're not that far in to the real, like, you know, the forms we're in now of streaming platforms, of anything, of social media on this level.
I remember doing shows where we would get like on electronic festivals like Azura. There were these guys throwing a shoe at Mabi.
Yeah.
And stuff. And you go, what the fuck? You know, like, or you go through fucking Germany. And like, I was on tour with Liebach.
Yeah.
Which sort of have a bit right wing leaning. And like, we'd come on stage after Liebach and 75% of the audience would leave the room.
Right.
75% because they did not want to see what we were presenting, which was a very sort of world vision underneath the skin, you know, fuck the skin. And, but they couldn't take it. And I think some audiences at that time couldn't take it. Whereas I think now, if you went into the electronic arena with that same show, it would be much more recognized for what it was.
I think so too. And I think we talked about it being also the market just stopped doing it as well. Like budget started, it was an expensive project to bring together for you, you know? So to get that kind of budget up front for a band like this, it was, that was all shifting as well.
Well, yeah, I think also the only reason we could do it when we did do it was because I didn't need to pay myself.
That's right.
Because I had the film stuff.
Right.
So it was always like, you know, working out pennies and pounds to get that show. You know, I'd spent 3 months on like a handful of dates, you know,
just
to do Europe. And
if had it been like another Juno album and not, didn't really challenge the listener, I think that was a time too where audiences were becoming very, very complacent of just like not wanting to be challenged. Just give it to me. You know, I don't want to have to think. I don't want, like, so the artist could still create something, but I think once it challenged, once you had to make sense, and it was a challenging set if you just wanted to be fed, like, you know, subwoofer bass, like DJ stuff, you know, and not experimental challenge, but I just think it's like they just wanted this kind of fast food mentality almost, and you're giving them something nutritious, and it's like...
I sort of get quite frustrated sometimes when I think about players that I know that are really top of their game players and they're doing shows for pretty much peanuts.
Yeah.
And you get a DJ going out there, you know, and it's like, whoa, yeah, big, impressive, everything. You know, they touch a knob and it's £160,000 in their pocket. You know, exactly. It's just so fucking bizarre. And it's quite sickening, really, but that's the way of the world, you know.
That's it. And like I said, it's not, at this point, I'm over my, you know, the real anger towards it and the frustration of it all. But at this point, it really, to me, it's just the lack of access we have to any of the real stuff. It's not a judgment or critique about it. I fully accept the world we're in. So I'm a purist in a sense of what moves me. But in terms of what I make my living at, I mean, I haven't, you know, every single thing I do is on a click track. And luckily I can play to a click track. So I keep working because if you don't, you don't.
Show us some of the instruments that you've actually got hanging around you now that you think would be quite interesting.
Yeah, well, the one I have that I just is the one I have to start with is the udu from
let's hear some of
that. Novris, the Novris udu, and this drum, I just still remember like that rhythm when you started playing your bass line. I remember you just had me and Mabi just start playing to it, you know, and I remember this was like.
Yeah, that's nice.
Yeah, so the bass tone, so there's a hole on top.
Yeah.
So you hit that and that pushes the air out. So that's where you get the sound. But then the skin allows you to bend the sound.
Very nice, yeah. It's a wonderful instrument.
Pattern you use then as kind of the fact, like that whole middle breakdown of that when the whole thing breaks down, it breaks down to just this boom. And I just love that, like in the midst of the whole Matrix franchise, CGI, the score, the orchestra, like all this stuff. There's actually one spot in that movie where you hear this, where you hear just a clay pot, you know? And it's just like the way you use that. And then the frame drum came in, right? And then the drums kick back in and... Deepak on the flute and everything, and Mabi doing his shakers.
Have you got ones with snares on the back as well?
There is one. Yeah, it's called the bindir. It's not up. It's not in the studio. But yeah, it has just
okay. Yeah, yeah. I love the frame drum, and I love your playing of the frame drum. Yeah,
yeah. And then the chan chans. We use this on Reloaded
I've got the same ones. I think
you got
these,
right? Yeah.
I think your Azam gave them to me.
We use this on God of Monsters a lot too, I think.
Yeah, a lot. I think we used them on pretty much every track.
Yeah. Yeah. So all these kinds of instruments, like a Balinese chan-chan is used with a gamelan orchestra. Mm. If you had an Indonesian play the chan-chan, he would be playing it as if he's playing it with the Balinese orchestra. To me, I play it like this real industrial hi-hat almost.
Yeah, yeah.
So I have a different vocabulary, but I'm still playing it with the effect it's meant to have.
Well, also that chan-chan can do so many different tones, can't it? It's got... Yeah.
But I think on Gods and Monsters, I think I played a lot with sticks, which I hadn't really done, and you actually encouraged that. So with the sticks, you can... like that kind of vibe, and then with...
Yeah.
There's so many things that you can do with this how to do it just on this one instrument. So
it's amazing.
That's
so
that's you really encourage that, I think, on this, well, all the stuff we've done. But you're hearing them as sounds. You're not
what's
hearing
that long thing. What's that long thing behind you? Is that a decoration or is that an instrument?
So there's a couple of these. They have them in different sizes.
Oh wow.
And so these, let me find a mallet to play them with. So with the small ones, these are from Ghana. But the big one, which I use a lot, is... And this one, when you play it on the ground, you get a really cool kind of...
Wow, that's nice.
So, yeah.
I mean, I'd like to put that through some effects, actually.
Well, what you do, that's meant to be played outside, like around a fire with dirt and dried leaves. So when you put the dried leaves underneath, it's like a foot hi-hat. So you get that, it's a really, really cool thing. So
I've still got the snare from Mabi. Did you go off to the junkyard with Mabi to pick up metal stuff?
No, I never made that journey with him.
Because, yeah, I still got it. I still got the sheet of metal that...
Oh, yeah, I remember that, yeah.
From the snare. It's really great. It's better than the electronic ones. It's fascinating. Anything, because that's what I think when it was, we were doing Navras, that we then experimented with a lot of different metal hits and stuff like that, car tires and...
Brakes as well, brake drums and stuff, and yeah.
Yeah, no, that was really, that's luxury, isn't it? It's luxury sort of musical life, all of that stuff.
Well, just that time you had at Ridge Farm, I just think of talk about like an opportunity that you took advantage of. I mean, that's amazing that you had access and that you were able to pull that off for that long to be there, you know?
I was there for 5 years, but
yeah,
it's funny how there's a good time to do certain things in certain places as well. But which films have you most enjoyed working on then in the past, you know, since Matrix and...
The experience has diminished for consistently, you know, each year you would have less and less of the experience being part of it. It was really the job. And you know, we got this studio for a day, or you're going to play this part, or, you know, send it to me at home and I'll do it here. There wasn't that creative kind of, you know, think tank really started diminishing in like after 2010. So, you know, working on Argo was incredible. Like I said, just to have that long with a composer of that level to just work on percussion in a place like Capitol. I mean, that was just incredible, you know, but our experience with Matrix, everything like that, that kind of coming from a place of musicians, not really film composers in that way of really knowing how far we can take something, that was really great. You know, with Tyler, we've had some ensemble things. As I'm thinking, pretty much all the best experiences when there's more than just me, when it's not just me layering my stuff and doing it. That's fun and everything. But I really enjoy when you're working with a few people and then these ideas start morphing like a great...
Do you get the same thing happening with like the video games?
Video games are just me. No, it's a solo show. And so, but I think there's an appreciation for what I bring to it because a lot of these guys haven't worked with these sounds before. So if they see a frame drum and they would just think a frame drum is those two sounds, and I come in and I... And then you get, you know... You know, and you get all these different textures. Then the next time I come in, they write with those things in mind. So their sound is expanding. So that's satisfying. And it's fun to be an influence. My live stuff is a whole different thing. If I go to any experience that I would share as being the ultimate, I don't think the top five would be a studio experience. Everything is live on that level of...
And have you ever thought of like getting a bunch of percussionists and players together and sort of doing a Ginger Baker style?
I think it's something that I would love to do. I think, again, the last 2 years have thrown all of my kind of optimistic plans off. You know, I was working on a documentary that was going to be going into production that summer in India. I was going to go back during 2020 and that got canceled. And I think... I'm just still resetting from that, but I was just kind of feeling this the other day of really wanting to get that kind of thing back into it, a new version of what that kind of planet drum would be. And so, yeah, that's something of course I'd want to do. I think that's where, if I wanted to spend any time on my own stuff, I want to spend it more generating live experience than recording another album, you know?
And the time that you spent in India, that must have been a massive influence on you as well, huh?
Yeah, influence. I mean, for 25 years I've been going, but I was there beginning of 2020. I was there for 2 months from January to March, and I had about like 25 gigs during that time. Like every few days it would be something. I was working with schools, going into the slums and working with musicians and playing with Zakir Hussain on this elite thing. I had all the range of it.
Wow.
But that country is just, as you know, I mean, if it hits you and you're open to it, man, there's no place like it in the world. And I think musically, I came back right before lockdown, just literally 4 days before the beginning of March, after 2 months of playing at that level. And I was like an Olympic athlete. I was just like, just peaking, you know, and then just, it just stopped. So that was, that country really does influence me on a lot of levels.
How'd you find that transition from like India to LA?
So when I got back after the 2 months there, I was doing solo gigs there. I was doing a 45-minute set, just myself and percussion, as a musical experience, not as a drum clinic or a solo and stuff. Like that is the concert. That is the act. Mm. And the appreciation and the commitment to what I would be doing was just incredible. So I came back and I had some gig here in downtown LA just a few days before lockdown at a place called Wisdom. So it's a geodesic dome and it's mostly DJs and electronics. So I get up there thinking I had just literally a week back from India on that level, and I just jump in and start going, and people were just like, they didn't get it at all. So
the sound in there is atrocious.
It is. And I think it's just that there's no value to it. That's really what it is. So I'm very aware of where I spend it now. If it doesn't have a good conversion rate, you know, like the rupee outside of India is nothing, but in India, it's a very valuable currency, you know? Yeah. And I think what I bring back to these, when I just did a gig for Iranian New Year's with a big group of Persian artists, and that community as well is really appreciative of what I do in terms of, they know I'm not a student of their music, but they know I could only play the way I do in it if I respected it on the same level.
The things I've seen and heard from Iran are just so amazing, so beautiful.
And especially the artist that has that kind of appreciation and respect for the culture. I think a lot of these cultures, you can look at the politics and maybe the you know, humanitarian side of things, like any country, and it's appalling on some levels, you know, India as well. But I think what these countries have is the ability to distinguish their legacy of art and culture as something other than their legacy of politics and power. You know, I really feel there's a, there with the Persian audiences I play for, with going to India, the audience still reveres the artist. The audience still really respects what the artist is, what the real artist is doing. And I've had that experience never in America in that way. And you get it there in a way that's just really powerful. And I think that's why you get that level of artist in these countries that are just levitating when they play sometimes.
We were working on Revolutions, and then you got a show put together and you said, Deepak, Mabi, do you want to do it or something like that? Yeah.
Yeah, because we were only, I think, all together for like a couple of weeks or something. And there was this really great jazz club called Rocco's in Hollywood at the time.
How long was Deepak there for?
Deepak may have only been, I don't think, longer than probably 4 or 5 days. I don't think it was long. Oh,
it felt longer. He felt like he came into the sort of family that was there and just fitted in like a ghost, you know, that came alive, because he just felt so natural in that environment.
Yeah, he really did. I remember the moments on the porch outside the studio of just talking and him playing and stuff. What a beautiful person. But I think we booked the gig before he had got there. I think you had said, well, maybe Deepak could do it as well and stuff. And I think I booked it with me and Mabi. And then once Deepak was there and we had this connection, the gig was like the next day or something like that. I think he jumped right into that. We didn't rehearse or anything, but that was really beautiful, because that was just like, I was still really fresh in terms of my live presentation of what I do. In the studio, I had it down. I had done so many films, so I could layer myself 30 times and hear, you know, create all kinds of things. But to do it live, I was still really apprehensive of not having that technique traditionally and putting myself out there like that. So I Mabi, do the gig with me, you know, and so Mabi could carry it. But and then with him and Deepak, but I was so amazed at how him and Deepak connected. That's what it was, really what you'll see in the footage, is that,
okay,
you know, of course Mabi and I and stuff, and then my kind of understanding of Indian music, but there's moments where Deepak is doing the Kona call, which is the takati na ta ta, the, you know, the vocal tabla. And Mabi is doing this, he's doing his whole thing too. And you see this blend of cultures that are just, it's really amazing.
We'll be right back.
I just remember loving how delicate, because obviously the Juno thing is a bit bombastic and it's like pedal to the metal a lot of the time.
Yeah.
And to see the reverse of that, which actually is sort of in an area where I'm quite interested now, you know, I'm far more interested in creating the space and the three-dimensional space rather than the going for the punch at the moment. But it's a shame I didn't have any of Mabi's really super delicate stuff down, because it was really delicate, wasn't it?
Yeah, and I did a recording here. I got him here. Mabi had told him about the recordings we had done here at my studio. And I do have a session of that as well. It's really kind of a bit meandering and stuff. And I just think, had an engineer been there, it would have been incredible, because I was trying to mic things up and trying to get Mabi to do something again. And it's like, you know, none of that was
working. It's hard to concentrate when you're... it's a weird thing, because that whole thing of miking things up and checking the sound and making sure nothing's very distorting or whatever. And then you've got to make, you know, then thinking, what are they actually doing?
Right.
How is that going to react to it? It is a funny thing, that whole sort of malaise of thoughts but I think it's only just through a process of doing it tons of times you get used to it.
Right.
I remember you and Mabi did that thing called The Bridge that, again, was quite delicate. It was for that.
Oh, yeah, yeah, right.
I think I've still got it somewhere.
Oh, I'd love to hear that. That was beautiful.
But there was other things that we did that we never released, like that 5/4 track.
That's right. Another good one. Wow, I have a CD of the original board mixes before I left. You gave it to me, and it's like before all the, you know, you went in and started, like, you know, doing your thing and stuff. But just it really sounded like a band. It really sounded like this kind of, like, we got in the studio and played, because we did, you know.
Well, I was really into that. What was that track, that Led Zeppelin track that's in 5/4, 5/6, 4/6, 5/6?
Oh, no, 4/6 is a different one. That's in 5.
That's the one. That's the one that I was really into at the time.
Yeah.
So we did something that was sort of similar to that. And I don't think I've ever finished it, because it just didn't ever feel like it was the right time to put something like that out. Because I think,
God, let's finish it now, man. Let's start with a couple of these if we have them. Seriously, yeah. Like, that would be amazing. If we have those things recorded and we can finesse that stuff, I'd love.
I mean, I wonder what stage it's at. It's in the vaults, in the cooker.
Yeah.
And maybe it's time to bring it out and see whether it's cooked.
How it's marinated. It could be a fine vintage, or it could be moldy as hell, man.
It could be, yeah. I know Sugizo's playing on it.
And he that's right, yeah.
He didn't play on many at that time.
Yeah.
I mean, there was things like Pretty Girl. And I mean, I really loved things like, what was it, Immaculate Crucifixion.
Thank you. still one of my favorite Juno tracks of all time. And one we never were able to, we never did it live, but that to me was the one I remember when we listened back to that in the control room when we tracked it. I had a glimpse of like, that could be the future of this kind of sound. Like there's just the bombasticness, but then that real tight electronic side, you know, and the big, that long ass build. Like, I've done that with people too in jams where they think I'm going 16 bars. Like, no, I go to 128 bars. trust me, this will pay off.
This will work. Yeah. No, that was really cool. Although the Juno fans at the time didn't really like that album. I think there's a number of them that had gone back to it and gone, well, actually, that's, you know, like I remember one guy said to me, oh, you know, when I heard Gods and Monsters, I hated it. Yeah. But then I had a daughter and then I listened to Pretty Girl. And then he said, I loved it so much. He then went back through the whole album and realized it wasn't a piece of shit that he thought it was.
No, it is. I actually just can't. I kind of checked it out. Probably it was right after Mabi passed. I think I was listening to a couple of tracks and just went down, spent a couple hours listening to stuff and did the whole album top to bottom as well. And it, like I said, it's bold. And it's not this idea when someone says bold, they think genius. It's like all you were doing was expanding your palette in such a way that you were bold enough to like try it and put it out there, you know, but
stupid.
It's a very eclectic record, you know?
Yeah, it is. I mean, I remember sort of seeing like after Labyrinth, you know, I was making the mistake of reading some of the reviews and things like that.
Right.
And people would say Juno Reactor with his typically epic sound. Right. And I thought, is it always epic? You know, maybe it is. And I thought, well, you know, let's just throw a curveball on this and see what happens. And see if...
Well, you threw a knuckleball, man. You threw beyond a curveball. You threw a googly, man.
Then and I did albums like Golden Sun of the Great East. People going, hey, Juno's back. Juno's back. Or with the last album, hey, Juno's back. And it's like, okay, you want me to be this this thing that just remains rigid in my little pigeonhole and I'll be that. But I think what I've always loved about the project is that when new people come in or people come back in, it's got like fresh blood and that influences the music. I mean, I think that's maybe why I'm really like through COVID and everything and the introspection of being in this room, like pretty much all my life.
Right.
You know, you go through different states of mental, whatever they are, but I went through something. And I found it incredibly introspective. And so I'm really ready to jump out of the introspection.
Yeah, I feel you, man. And I really relate to that. I think a lot of us relate to that, certainly in the collective sense. But I know specifically, I know what you mean. And that, I was just thinking like how, and I'm going to compare it to artists that aren't, I'm not comparing on terms of any kind of, you know, iconic level or anything necessarily, but someone like a Miles Davis who never reinvented himself. He always just surrounded himself with fresh musicians, you know? So Miles will play the same on Bitches Brew that he, in the same way that he could have played on Milestones, but it's a totally different sound because of who he surrounded himself with.
Yeah.
He was always clear about that, of bringing that fresh energy in, you know? And in jazz, it's usually young guys that they bring in because the young guys haven't, you know, just been doing it for so long that there's any kind of jadedness. But what you did, what I see now in perspective, looking back at like 20 some odd years of how it's all been for you, I feel like one of Miles's musicians in that way. Like I'm really grateful I had that. I was in that phase of it, you know, looking at like the whole kind of Juno Reactor thing. When somebody says like, oh, Juno's Reactor's back. Like to me, that's usually only said with artists that it's never reinventing themselves, but it's always like, how far can I take this? Let me see what this works. And so if you consciously pull it back for your fans.
I think it's the sound. I think they just like that sort of more electronic side of things, which is cool. That's all right.
But because it's really good electronic stuff too. You know what I mean? You're not getting that really anywhere else. It's very distinct. But then this other world vision you brought into it was also very distinct that didn't necessarily give that all the time. So
I mean, it's been really weird because I'd love to play back in America, you know, and I get offered shows, but like a DJ show here or a DJ show there, and it's, you just can't make it work. But, and I've, for many years, I've been trying to get a band shows back into America, but they make it so difficult for you.
They do. I know. It's
and so that's why it hasn't happened. But I'm always looking, you know, it'd be amazing to do an American show. And I've been having this sort of like an alternative project I'd really like to do that's very much more metal orientated.
Oh, wow. Cool.
But whether that happens, I doubt it will ever happen. But it's just one of my little fantasy bands that keep off in my head. I got the name and the T-shirt, but not the energy to run it. So thanks a lot for coming on, Greg. And it's really nice to see you.
Yeah, I think it's been really nice.
And I hope we get to do some new things in the future.
I hope so,
and,
too.
Yeah, thanks for coming.
Yeah, it's my pleasure. Being part of it and just the whole Juno world all this time has just been fantastic. So, yeah, let's reconnect and keep it going, man. Good to see you.
Nice one. Thanks, Greg, for coming along on the last of this series of Inside the Juno Reactor. And I'd like to thank all of you for listening, for coming along, making comments, having a laugh, and getting to know some of you. It does make me think a lot about how special everyone that's come inside Juno Reactor has been, and how much they've sort of put into it, progressed the project, kept the blood flowing. It's very special. And I'd like to thank Marrow at Kenji Productions for producing these shows. And I hope you join us once again inside the Juno Reactor.